Oh, wow. So I feel like there's almost no need for the introduction, given that so many people showed up. Can I start by saying again, good afternoon from my side. I think it is my distinct pleasure to welcome all of you to our next session, which is a discussion with Madame Danièle Nouy, who is the chairman of the ECB's of the SSM Supervisory Board at the ECB, as I'm sure you all know. Ms. Nouy has held this role as SSM chairman since it was initially formed, or created, should I say, in 2014. The SSM is part of the institution building of the European Banking Union and obviously its key constituent bloc. In her role as chairman, Madame Nouy is responsible for the supervision of the Eurozone's banking system. I'm just going to touch briefly on Madame Nouy's previous positions. She has had a long career in banking supervision, holding various positions at the Basel Committee, ACPR, the French Banking Commission, as well as Banque de France. Now, Ms. Nouy, I'm aware that this introduction could go on for a very long time because of your CV. Then again, I think the full room, as I mentioned at the beginning, suggests that the participants are indeed very familiar with the role that you play and the importance that you have in the supervision of the European banking system. So before I stop, may I please say thank you for joining us here today. I realize that you had to travel from Frankfurt for this, and I suspect that this remains a very intense period when it comes to the European bank supervision. So thank you for making the time and thank you for joining us. Jean-François and I will kick it off with a few questions. I'll ask the participants to get their questions ready because we're going to hand over to the audience very quickly. So Jean-François, over to you.
Yes. Thank you for your participation also from my side. And I would like to start with a question on the first year and a half, essentially, of operation of the SSM. In your mind, what has been the key achievement of that year and a half? And also, where has the single supervision made the principal difference? The question, in other words, is what would not have been possible had the supervision stayed national?
Well, first of all, thank you for inviting me. Thank you to all of you for joining this discussion. Good afternoon. Well, during this short period of time, the differences that were brought by the banking union on the first pillar, the single supervisory mechanism, was first of all its existence, because it was built in a very short period of time. Second, probably the comprehensive assessment. That was a huge huge project to review the situation of the banks that we were about to supervise, asset quality reviews, stress tests. And it was very helpful to start knowing very well the banks that we would supervise immediately after. We did also a lot of work regarding harmonization, the national options that are, in my view, too numerous in European legislation and regulation. We also built a single methodology for the Pillar 2 calculations, the review and evaluation process of the banks, the SREP. And also, I must say, we raised awareness about possible issues. We made denial impossible on certain issues like national options, for example, but also non-performing exposures, sovereign exposures. And we helped a journey to be started on these important issues.
Maybe the last question before we open it up to the audience. We heard from a multiple of banks which have presented thus far that there's concern on the levels of profitability, and I think at some point a low level of profitability becomes a financial stability issue as well. I think the SSM made the sustainability of the business model and sustainable level of profitability one of its key areas for examination over the course of this year. I was just wondering, how do you observe the levels of profitability in the system and how concerned are you?
We should not forget what we are coming from. A number of banks and a number of countries have been seriously hit by the recent crisis in the euro area. So a number of them still have legacy assets, for example, and they are addressing those assets. The context is a difficult context as well. We are in a low growth, low inflation environment, which means that the recovery process is challenged by this context, and that has to be taken into account. This being said, this recovery is taking place, and the banks have to take the opportunity of this recovery, of these more difficult times, to reassess the sustainability of their business models, to make in-depth analysis of their profitability drivers. And it is important because, indeed, you need to be profitable, to be well capitalized. And that's why, from the very beginning, sustainability of business models, profitability drivers have been on the top of the list of our priorities.
Okay, so with that, we will open it up to Q&A from the audience. Please signal your interest to ask a question. A word of warning, this session is being webcast in compliance with ECB's disclosure policies, so you are on live TV as you're asking the questions, be aware of that. also, please introduce yourself and your institution as you ask your question. But I think we've got the first question right there. Oh, we already have one there, sorry.
Sorry, I've been given the microphone, so I'm gonna start. We've seen a number of new initiatives. Sorry, Xavier Van Ho from THS Partners.
Excellent.
We've seen a number of new initiatives in the last few years, and I'm just going to read them because I can't remember them all. There's obviously the SSM, the SREP, the EBA, the SRBD, then there's all sorts of regulations, CRD4, stress test, CCB, Pillar 3, FSB, TLAC, GSIBs, SRM, additional Tier 1, Tier 2, LCR, CRD4, AQR, Basel 4. Is it perhaps now enough? Has it got complicated enough? Can we hope for a slight simplification going forward?
Well, this is what can be seen after a crisis. The regulation is reviewed, the supervision is enhanced in order to make sure that the probability that such a big crisis happens again is much lower. But I agree with you, this is time for implementation right now. And in particular, related to the previous question, if we want the banks to rethink their business models, their profitability drivers, they need a stable environment. So we very much support a quick end to the regulatory reform, and this is what should happen with the Basel Committee finalizing the current project by the end of the year.
Madame Nouy, perhaps a different way to ask this question is, in your mind, how far down the line to reaching a new steady state on terms of regulation and supervision are we?
Well, in supervision, I start with this one because it's probably the most easy. On supervision, we are not yet where we want to be. We have a long journey on certain issues, for sure, and I'm sure you know those issues. Regarding regulation, the supervisory board of the SSM said last year, myself, we said last year, that we thought we were in the steady state for capital requirement. We have not changed our mind, and we are in the camp, a very large camp, as a matter of fact, for sure a majority, if not a consensus, that believe that the reforms still to come before the end of the year should not trigger a significant increase of capital requirements. Namely Pillar 1 requirements. And I have an interest in that because as a supervisor, I want to see still room for Pillar 2, for the judgment of supervisors. I think good supervision can make a difference, but for that we need this tool, which is Pillar 2. And if the Pillar 1 requirement was to go up again, in this case there will be less room for Pillar 2, which will not be a good thing.
Excellent. Okay, let's take the next question, please. Right there.
Hi, Heather Takahashi from Three Bridges Capital. I had a question about the Italian banks. So it appears, you know, the ECB has been taking action to encourage them to offload NPLs and raise capital if necessary, but you know, just looking at the stock price reaction of the Italian banks, it seems to have had perhaps the unintended consequence of increasing their cost of capital. I'm wondering, does that matter to you? And if so, what actions would you take?
Well, I'm not quite sure what is the precise question. What you said about Italian banks can be said about other banks in the euro areas. We have a number of banks in a number of countries that have some legacy asset to address. We started addressing legacy assets by having the asset quality review of the comprehensive assessment, identifying those assets with a common definition for the first time delivered by EBA. Then, once identified, they had to be reasonably well provisioned through this asset quality review and also through the stress test exercise. So now we have a very sound basis to move to the next step regarding this issue. We have a high-level group on non-performing exposures that is close to produce its report and offer solutions that will have to be discussed by the supervisory board and decided upon. There will be a consultation anyway on anything that is decided. So, you know, on such an important issue, there could not be less than 2 months consultation. So, and then we integrate the outcome of the consultation. So it takes time before it is guidance. And it's obviously the final recommendation will be more for the steady state and the new loans, not to create new non-performing exposures. And for the rest, each bank will have to address in a dialogue with the supervisor how they move from the current situation to the steady state. And to a certain extent, it's like a marathon because not you have banks that are closer to the finishing line in this big issue, in this journey, and others that have still more work to do. It's also the decision of the bankers to decide whether they want to move faster in order to benefit maybe for new opportunities in the SSM area, in the euro area banking systems, or whether they prefer to address that more gradually, but they will have to carry them for a longer period of time. So it's not nothing specific, if I understood properly your question, to the Italian banks.
In terms of the second part of the question, if I understood it correctly, there was a question whether the SSM takes into consideration the fact that the market seems to have taken a negative view on the impacts of NPL initiatives for the Italian banks, and the cost of equity for those banks has risen. I guess a different way to asking this question is, does the level of market capitalization or the share price enter into the equation at the SSM?
SSM is about level playing field and consistency. So we cannot consider each segment, each market for investors. Investors should start thinking European probably, on the euro area probably. So the solution should not be looked for simply on a single market. But depending on the capacity or lack of capacity to get fast the possible equity needed, the banks may choose to move more slowly. Again, the comprehensive assessment has provided us a very sound basis to take the banks from where they are right now to the finishing line of the marathon.
Okay, let's take the next question. Let's take one from the back, right there.
Tara Camudia, Biber Capital. I was just more on the issue of legacy assets. Mr. Constanzio mentioned after the last ECB meeting that, you know, there's a possibility of task force being introduced to enforce solutions for individual banks on NPLs. And I'm just curious if you could provide more color on that or any more detail. Because obviously it's, you know, going back, it looks like you were in some sort of consultation period and that's moved towards plans for individual banks. And I'm curious how you're going to address that.
Hang on. So can I just, what the question is?
Yeah, Mr. Constanzio said that there would be the ECB or the SSM would enforce plans to deal with legacy assets or NPLs at individual banks, or task force would be established to deal with NPLs. And I'm curious how, you know, what initiatives or what plans are in place to address these issues.
So I think. I must have missed this comment from Mr. Constanzio, but maybe.
Well, I have not seen what Victor Constanzio said, but I presume he said things that I could have said myself as well on non-performing exposure. So a group, high-level task force on non-performing exposures exists already, yes, and has been working hard for months, doing a very good job. So now they are close to deliver some proposals to the supervisory board, and we have also to consider the whole sequence on the good calendar. The first event for the banks that are in the EBA stress test will be the publication of the outcome by let's say between mid and end of July. Then all the banks at a certain moment in the fall will receive their SREP decisions from the supervisors. And according to the recommendation of EBA and ESMA, they will probably be published, those requirements for SREP. Because the banks decide, that's why I put it this way. The decision of publishing, not publishing, market abuse directive, soon to come market, or maybe already just came a few days ago, the regulation on market abuse put the responsibility in the hands of the bank. So we have to consider another element of the calendar is the new IFRS rule about provision of expected losses as well. So we will probably go public first sometime in the summer or fall with the qualitative part of how to manage non-performing exposures. Then there will be a more quantitative part, I would imagine, beginning of next year for the steady state and for the new loans. And indeed, banks will receive in a supervisory dialogue, depending on their situations, depending on their strategy, recommendation, individual recommendation from their supervisor.
And Madame Nouy, the NPL task force, is that led from the ECB, from the Financial Stability Division, or from the SSM?
It's led by a person that has all the capacities for doing the job, namely, it's already public, Sharon Dunnery, Deputy Governor of the Irish Central Bank, a country that knew about such a problem, that had to address the problem and did a good job in addressing the problem. So I think it's better to take, as usual, the best person for the job. And she is, in my view, the best person for the job. Then all the national supervisory authorities contributed and were part of the thinking and have had a say in the proposals.
Excellent. Okay. Where should we continue? Perhaps over there.
Yes, thank you. It's Philippe Bolo from PIMCO. Just if you could give us an update on the progress you're making on the MDA discussion, which obviously has been a big focus for the market in January, February. If you could give us maybe a sense of your thinking on that front, and as well as the timeline for any kind of new legislation coming through. And the second one is on the sequencing for the next few months, especially the sequencing between the publication of the stress test by the EBA in July and the SREP letters in November. I'm a bit worried that there's a lot of data is going to be published to the market. We know it's going to inform the SREP requirement, but there's a very long period of time during which people are going to try to reverse engineer what's going to happen there. And I think that just in itself is a source of risk, so I wanted to understand why you don't publish the two things together.
Well, to start with, because we will not be ready at the same time, and the same people are the ones dealing with the stress test, and the ones dealing with the SREP decisions. But let me try to clarify this. I'm sure you are aware of the European Commission note on Pillar 2 requirements, on Pillar 2 guidance for this year. And we are very pleased that we got this clarification, because this is what we had asked the European Commission to clarify the way the staking order of the buffers and the different elements should be considered. So again, as we said last year, we are in the steady state, so it means that the requirements of last year will be split this year into a requirement part and a guidance part. This should not be new for you, because this is the way our British colleagues are addressing this issue. And only the requirements are MDA relevant, not the guidance, because there is no automaticity in transforming the guidance into a requirement. And as our British colleagues are doing, the outcome of the stress test are expected to be in the guidance, so there will not be MDA relevant. Obviously, you know the different elements that enter into the SREP requirements. Credit risk, market risk, governance, business model, profitability, ICAP, ILAC, and so on and so forth. So I don't imagine that the stress test, either the baseline or the adverse scenario, will produce something that we were ignoring before the stress test. So part of the outcome, not mathematical, not in a mathematical fashion, but part of the information provided by the stress test is already known and is already in the different blocks that contribute to the Pillar 2 requirements. But the result of the stress test themselves are part of the guidance, and in the guidance, not even in a mathematical fashion either. In particular, because as you know, this is not a fail-pass exercise this year. So the stress tests are not expected to have an influence on the level of the MDA. I hope I was clear enough.
I think it was very clear. You can go on, but these are complex topics nonetheless. Okay, Len, go ahead.
Hi, it's Len Riddell from TIA. You've made it clear that a level playing field is very important to you. The Dutch regulator, DNB, has imposed a 300 basis point D-SIB buffer for their banks, which is obviously completely against your level playing field. So to what extent do you put pressure on such a regulator to remove such a buffer?
Right, so national versus
Well,
SSM.
There are elements which are in the hands of the SSM because prudential issues. And there are buffers, other elements which are not in the hands of the prudential regulator. Global SIFI buffer, or domestic SIFI buffer, have been decided by other people for other reasons. Macro prudential buffer have a strong national dimension. So we exercise our responsibilities, and the people that have this task, these responsibilities, macroprudential buffer, domestic SIFIs, exercise their responsibility. We don't put any pressure on anybody. We respect the work that is done by the people working with us to get a safer and sounder banking system.
Perhaps as a follow-on to that question, as the European Banking Union advances and we have a functioning single resolution mechanism, do you still anticipate for that to be a substantial difference on the DSIB side or not that much? Do you see it as a temporary measure of somebody like the Dutch regulator or not?
Frankly, I don't know. This is not something on which I have a view for the time being, with how long it could last. It depends very much on the context, obviously. So if the context is changing, it may change. I have no crystal ball.
Okay. All right, let's take one question from this side of the room, if there are any. No, you can't have another one. Hang on. No? We have shy people here, and then lots of questions.
No, there was
there.
Somebody else.
Okay, yeah. Please go ahead. Yeah, sorry.
Hi, it's Benjamin Billiard from Eleva Capital. You highlighted the importance of discretion for the national regulator in the Pillar 2. Can we expect more differentiation in terms of SREP going forward?
Well, there should be room for supervisor's judgment. That's my stance. This being said, it's a certain room in a certain framework. What we can do is describe in the regulation and in CRD4. And there is an EBA guidance that explains how the discretion should be exercised. So we are, in this respect, fully complying with this framework, which is delivering consistency in Europe. What we want to do as well is to be, as I have said several times, tough and fair, fair and tough, because the two go together. You cannot be tough if you are not fair. It's just impossible. So we are able to conduct a number of horizontal tests, to use different kinds of benchmark to make sure that we are treating properly each on any of the significant institutions that we are supervising. So yes, there is room for supervisor judgment, but not total discretion to, and that's just normal and fair.
Okay, next question, please.
Sorry, coming back to the, Jérôme Legras from Axiom Alternative Investments. Coming back to the topic of Italian NPLs, you said they were mostly addressed in the AQR. Mr. Draghi said they were adequately provisioned. So presumably, I think most of us believe that Popolare di Milano and Banco Popolare had adequate provisioning, and still when the merger was announced, they said they had to increase provisions by roughly 1 billion euros. So could you explain us the rationale for that, and why did the merger trigger an increase in provisioning, which doesn't seem obvious to me, and should we expect similar decisions in possibly future transactions?
Well, I will not comment individual cases, so I will not comment on these two banks. What I will say is that we have, first of all, that mergers are very serious operations that will change seriously the risk profile of the banks, and that's why we are very cautious when we are accepting or putting conditions to possible mergers. Our stance is that the new bank has to be strong from the very beginning, promise to be stronger over time, in the future, is not good enough, it's not delivering. And there is another issue, which is just common sense. If you take two banks which are in medium size, let's say, and if by merging them you create one of the of the first five banks in a country, whatever country, the same for everybody, then you want to compare the new bank with the new peer group, with the new category. And we expect, obviously, the big banks, the systemic banks, to be, even domestically systemic banks, to be safe and sound. So, yes, what could have been enough and reasonably good as a starting point to address certain issues for two medium-sized banks or three medium-sized banks or four medium-sized banks before a merger, if they decide to move together and to become a systemic bank for the country on the SSM, well, they will be judged with the new criteria, for sure.
And maybe to stay on the point of M&A, just for one more second, and we had a brief discussion on this previously. So at the start of 14, I think that the president of the ECB outlined the end direction of travel for the European Bank Union. And I think he said something along the lines of that national borders should not matter, and the capital and liquidity within the Eurozone, bank capital and bank liquidity, should become fungible. I think that we are now all looking back on those statements and saying there's a disconnect between perhaps the theoretical intent and the practicalities. How do you see it? Do you think we are moving in that direction?
Well, yes, indeed, we are moving in this direction, but we are in a transition period of time. And let me remind you that the transition has been very fast, even if you consider that maybe it should be faster. It took decades to get the single currency. The banking union was decided in less than 2 years. Then hardly more than 2 years, you had the single supervisory mechanism. Then coming just after, a year after, the single resolution mechanism. So indeed, we are not in the steady state in this respect. The third pillar of the banking union is still to be created. The single resolution fund that goes with the single resolution mechanism is not yet built and funded, and the solidarity has not started. If I remember well, the piece of regulation that will be in the steady state in 2023, that's a fact. I'm pretty convinced that the so-called EDIS, the single deposit guarantee scheme for the banking union, the third pillar, will come pretty fast as well. Here as well, the national deposit guarantee schemes are starting from different points, very different points. So there will be a phasing for this national deposit guarantee scheme to turn into the European guarantee scheme. This period of time in parallel, not in a sequence, but in parallel, this period of time will be used to reduce risk in the euro area. The two elements are leveraging each other, third pillar on reduction of risk. And then we will be in the steady state. The world has already changed a lot, pretty fast in my view, but there is more to come, yes, before we can say it's a single banking system.
Okay, hang on, there's a question over there.
Hi, it's Arantxa Cano from More Capital. I'm just going to pick on your comments on the pending Basel IV regulation, and I think it makes a lot of sense. It comes through Pillar 2. The question is, the quantum from the proposal seems very large, and seems very large for some specific banks. And also, it's the first time some of these proposals are affecting households and corporates. So what's your view around the quantum of these proposals?
Well, the stance is no significant increase of the current Pillar 1 capital requirements. Outliers will be it for certain of them. Certain banks are outliers, so they will see a difference. But again, broadly, on average, should not be a significant increase. Obviously, the impact analysis, the consultation is based on reasonably pessimistic parameters, because otherwise you can always decrease. You cannot increase after a consultation period. So I'm sure my colleagues were prudent when they went out with their proposals. But at the end of the day, there will be analysis of these results, and we will make sure that we get where we want to get. And I have seen a number of pieces of research or analysis regarding the possible developments. A common feature is that they all take the worst parameter for each element, the toughest parameter for each element. Obviously, if you do that, the outcome is scary, but this is not going to happen.
So calibration is key.
Calibration is key, indeed.
All right. Next question. Oh, no, sorry, hang on. There's one over there. Chauncey.
Thank you, Chauncey Upson, Visium. Just a question on trust and on believability. When you meet management teams or investors, the view is that rules, while uncertain in terms of their calibration, may be changed or not adhered to ex post facto, whether it's Novo Banco, whether it's Italian bank consolidation, whether it's banks that have passed AQR and subsequent to that been forced to raise equity to cover legacy assets. So my question is, how do you view the believability and trust that capital markets should have in this process? Because it seems very low.
Well, I think clarity, certainty, transparency are very important for the investors on capital market, and we should ensure that. But with the example that you have quoted, I don't see, thanks God, anything we are responsible for. It was the measures that you are mentioning were not taken by the ECB, to the best of my knowledge. And I'm certain it's not the best of my knowledge only.
Okay.
So we are committed, maybe that's better to say it like that, we are committed to clarity, transparency, and as much certainty as possible. We cannot have certainty on the exact final outcome of the Basel Committee reforms, for example. We are not in the driving seat. We are not the regulators. We are the supervisors. But I can tell you that we are committed as members of those this committee, the Basel Committee, the so-called GOS, the committee with governors and head of supervision that take the final decision, to stick to our stance of not no significant increase coming from this reform.
On aggregate.
On aggregate, yes, obviously. On aggregate.
Okay, so we got a minute of time left, so I'm going to turn to Jean-Francois if you have any questions.
Sure. The question I wanted to ask you was, looking forward, now that we have the single supervision mechanism, we still have very few pan-European, true pan-European banks. And the question is, from your point of view, from a supervisory point of view, do you believe that more pan-European banks, larger banks, are desirable from a financial stability perspective? And what are the obstacles before we start maybe seeing some more of that, as we've seen larger banks rather shrinking than growing really recently?
We certainly need more Europe, not less Europe in the banking sector. There are already a number of banks which can be considered pan-European banks. A number of the banks that we are supervising are very important, systemic, domestic in several countries of the euro area. I'm pretty sure that this will go on. We are offering with the SSM, the SRM on tomorrow with a single mechanism for deposit guarantee, the framework that makes it not only possible but probably desirable also for market participants. I think the moves should be taken by the market participants. It's market participants that have to decide about the merger they want to promote and the shape of the European banking system that is to be developed. But we offer the framework, the consistency, the level playing field. It may take also certain additional legislative reforms to make it even more desirable. Capital Market Union, for example, is a great project that should be promoted and that will be helpful. New bankruptcy laws that will be on consistent bankruptcy laws in the different countries will help Market Union, will help also the supervisors in addressing the non-performing issues. New laws for repossession of collateral, for example, as the Italian legislators are taking right now, because you were very much interested in developments in Italy. I think that is going into the right direction and will help the consolidation of the system, banking system within the euro area.
Excellent. Well, Madame Nouy, we're out of time. I would like to thank you again on behalf of Goldman Sachs and our clients, investors in European banks, for engaging with the market. We think it's a very refreshing attitude. Thank you very much.
Thank you.